This Week in Startups is brought to you by IBM Smart Camp, powered by Launch. Over 20 cities worldwide, get mentored, pitch on stage, compete to win investment from Jason, and become IBM Global Entrepreneur of the Year. Apply at smartcamp2016.com. And Walker Corporate Law, a boutique law firm specializing in the representation of entrepreneurs. Visit them at walkercorporatelaw.com. Our iTunes review of the week is from Zilling Gong. Jason's experience as an entrepreneur and successful angel investor adds to the extraordinary guests in the trenches, toiling to make humanity better via startups.
Next up, another great entrepreneur, another great American, Glenn Kelman. Glenn, we met, I guess, back when you were funded by Sequoia early on, and I was at Sequoia as well. And you had this crazy idea that you were going to disrupt the real estate business. Tell me what the original idea was.
Well, the original premise was that we were going to build technology to take the real estate agent completely out of the equation. And what we found was that people still had questions when they bought houses. They need to access the property. That eventually we'd have to hire real estate agents. I wonder, though, do you remember when we met during my time at Redfin?
Don't. I don't exactly remember. Were we
at
a party?
That is so crazy. It meant so much to me. It meant nothing to you.
No, it did. I was always fascinated by your business. But I'll tell you, I have this happen a lot where like I have some meaningful conversation with a person and then I forget because I talk constantly.
Oh, well, here's the situation. Okay, so Redfin went through a hard time. Uh-huh. We were struggling to raise money and I wasn't sure if our board was going to be supportive of the company. And you took the meeting out of the blue with me because I just needed advice. I was in Pasadena. I had to get all the way to Santa Monica. Uh-huh. You had an orange crazy Tesla parked in the parking lot. I was mad because it had taken me 2.5 hours to get there.
Yeah, it was brutal.
And then I went in there and I said, I just don't know if our current investors are going to support this deal. And if they don't support the deal, who will? And then you told me that I should just ask, that I should ask them if they're supportive. You said, it's not like you're in junior high and there's a girl you like and you don't want her to know.
Right.
You should just find out.
Right, quickly.
Yes, and even though it's a gendered term, you told me to grow a pair, which was hard to hear.
Yeah.
As a 36-year-old man.
Right.
But I went back to our board and I said, I just need to know where I stand.
Yes,
we're not doing great, but this is a great idea. If you're not gonna support it, we're gonna have to find another way.
Yeah.
Are you gonna let this die or are you gonna stand by us?
Wow.
And they did.
Wow.
They
that was good advice I gave.
So you saved my ass. You saved my ass.
Well, you know what
and
I tell you?
And you forgot.
You
That's
get,
because
no.
you've saved so many asses.
You know what? It's great.
I even sent you a note saying you saved my
you did,
ass.
You did. I do remember it now.
he does not.
It was. I remember just thinking back. No, I do remember it actually now that you bring it up. And,
can
you know,
I give you the irony?
Yeah. The
paradigm. Irony is that in the slides, there was a picture of you giving me this advice. And then I asked the people putting on the show, has Jason reviewed the slides? And
no.
They said he's very careful in his preparation.
Yeah.
So you've forgotten about it twice.
Exactly. well, listen, I just want to tell you I'm glad that the company survived because has anybody actually used Redfin before to buy or sell?
Oh yeah.
Now that's using Redfin. That was like almost a half of the audience there. How many people have actually used it for a transaction? Actually gotten a refund? 1, 2, 3? Anybody else? Like 3, yeah. So that makes sense because you know, not everybody's buying and selling homes, not that often. And that happens every 10 years or so. I just want to give a small anecdote. I was trying to buy a home here in San Francisco. Took me 5 or 6 offers. I used Redfin.
Yeah.
It was the first time I ever felt like the agents were on my side, not their side.
That's the whole point.
Which is the whole point, because you incentivize them to get a great salary, great benefits. And this is the key that I think is so brilliant. They're not incented by any individual transaction. They're incented by the form you send to them to say, rate the agent.
Yes.
That's how their compensation is determined.
Yes.
And they're buying into it. The two agents I worked with were like, this is the best job I've ever held. They buy into it.
Good. Yeah, so the basic idea is that we built the world's best real estate site. We invented map-based search, and so agents don't have to spend time prospecting for business. The internet does that just fine. And then we've built all this technology to make it easy to get into a home, to make it easy to fill out the paperwork. And we've got these real estate agents, our own employees, who handle all the questions and help you get into properties and write the offers and do all the paperwork. So the idea has been really fruitful. The business has grown to hundreds of millions of dollars in revenue. It grows 40 to 50% a year, but it's a mission-driven business. The idea is that real estate can be a total sales trap and we can make it better if we just put the customer first. So I've been at it a little while, but it's by far the most rewarding thing I've ever done. And because it's such a large market, I think I'll be doing it for a long while to come.
And when you pay that 5% fee typically or whatever it is, yeah. You guys give back a half a point or a point, some amount gets back.
Well, it depends.
If you're the buyer.
On the sell side, we give back about 2 points. We charge 1% instead of 3% to be your listing agent. And on the buy side, we give between half a point and a point back.
Which is significant.
Yeah, a customer saves around $10,000 in fees on average if they're buying one house and selling another.
It's amazing
that
you give that money back. You were hated. I remember when I first started looking at the product in Los Angeles, and I started telling people I'm using Redfin, I mean, the other brokers were upset. Like, physically upset. They were like, Redfin is the worst, you're not getting advice, they're not looking out for you. Then, when I did it this time around, maybe 6-7 years later, people were like, oh, you have a Redfin agent? Yeah, no, that's great. You know, they were. Everybody was cool about it. What happened?
Market share. So I think part of it was that I was on 60 Minutes and I was a little obnoxious about it where I said, we're going to come for you now.
Right.
And I called
real estate.
It was
your fault. Yeah.
I called real estate the most screwed up industry in America. It wasn't a good idea. But I have to say that we sold our own house and somebody chainsawed our yard sign and people pooped in our toilet and didn't flush it while they were touring. And it was just a horrible experience at the beginning. So now things have sort of settled down. We've gotten some share. We have nearly 5% share in a lot of major markets, and we've just become a fact of life. And the fact that we save people money and get people into homes faster and give better service, eventually folks respect that.
I wanted to talk to you about sort of what you've learned in all this. Most features don't matter. I mean, this is pretty obvious, I guess, in hindsight, or?
Yeah, I guess I just look back at most of my time at startups as a giant waste of time where you build all these features that really don't matter. The person who's pictured here is Adam Weiner, our chief growth officer, who really has focused me on just performance. The more we've invested in having the web page or the app load faster, the more people have come to the site. And obviously, you have to have product market fit first. So we knew that people wanted to see pretty pictures of listings. And the more we messed around with anything else, the more we just stopped traffic growth. So getting as much inventory as we possibly could, serving it up as quickly as possible, just having the discipline of that simplicity has made a huge difference. And of course, you do have to iterate constantly when you haven't figured out what people want, but once you do, you can become your own worst enemy and just add a lot of features to the site that really don't matter. And so I would just say that you should keep it really simple. Once you have something, make it really fast and beautiful and easy to use, and just look at everything else that you could add to the site as potentially a detraction rather than an addition to the site.
Because you add it, it can confuse people.
Yeah.
And it has to be maintained as well.
Yeah, you know, you just increase the surface area of the product. So every once in a while, we just go through it and kill a bunch of stuff that nobody's really using. Redfin to this day is basically 2 or 3 web pages. It's a map with a bunch of listings on it. And then when you click on one of those listings, it's the listing itself. And just making that page load extremely fast and then sending alerts very quickly when new properties come on the market is really the only thing that's ever worked for us. There's lots of work we've done to make conversion faster, to work out fulfillment. But in terms of customer acquisition, just performance has mattered more than anything else. And so lots of times I get together with founders for lunch. They think they're Steve Jobs. They've got all sorts of ideas about how they're going to have this vision and add this and that to the site. And it just sounds like so much noise. And it reminds me of myself when I was 33. I really think that most products are incredibly simple. The products you love the most are really, really simple.
I call it the feature death march that some companies decide to go on, which is the next feature is the one that'll make us grow. When in fact, it might be you've already done the feature that'll make you grow. You just haven't focused on the growth tactics, marketing, customer acquisition, you know, and all the blocking and tackling, and don't have a growth team.
Yeah, and part of it is that as you iterate, you really don't have a way to figure out what's working and what isn't. An early stage company hasn't elaborately instrumented the site or the app to be able to measure what's working and what isn't. And so when I talk to people, I say, well, why do you think that was such a great idea? And they really don't know what worked and what didn't. So just building an infrastructure where you can run a lot of tests all at once and see what works and what doesn't, and taking yourself out of the process and all your beautiful design ideas, I think will actually often lead to a better result.
Hey, everybody, I want to tell you about the second year of us partnering with IBM for something called Smart Camp. We had a great partnership last year, and now we're on to smartcamp2016.com. It's a startup competition. It occurs in 20 cities from around the world, and you can find your city on the website, smartcamp2016.com, smartcamp2016.com, or you can find the city closest to you, one you can get to, and you can apply. Applications are closing in a few weeks, so I need you to apply today. And if you win, you're going to get to pitch on stage at the Launch Festival or the Scale Conference, and you're going to get mentored by local IBM city leaders, and you can compete for a chance to be a finalist. So you're going to pitch on stage in your city, become a finalist, you're going to crush it, and then you're going to come to the Scale Conference or the Launch Conference. It's going to be great. The top 10 finalists get to come to the Launch Festival in the spring of 2017 here in San Francisco. They get to meet with me. You have lunch with me. It's great fun. And the top 3 finalists are going to present on stage at the Launch Festival in front of thousands of people. The winner will get $25,000 from me and come to my exclusive incubator, the Launch Incubator. Last year, CarForce went to the incubator and received an investment from me. Actually doubled my investment in the company, went from 25 to 50. And you will become the IBM Global Entrepreneur of the Year, a title you want to have in your pitch deck when you go meet with investors. So go ahead and visit smartcamp2016.com and start your journey. It's going to be an amazing conference, an amazing competition, and you're going to learn a lot, and you might wind up getting an investment from me, Jason Calacanis. Okay, let's get back to this amazing program.
You know, I just had Reed visit us at an offsite. You know, he's an amazing person. But one of the things he talked about was this idea that sometimes the team just needs someone to make a decision, and being explicit about this idea that you are going to make the decision because you're the CEO or because you're the head of product or whatever role you have as an entrepreneur can sometimes just settle the debate, because you're not actually saying, I know for certain that what I think is right. We just have to make a decision, and it's formalizing the caprice, because the uncertainty that I lived in, especially in the early days where we were trying so many different things, was really unsettling. And the idea that I had to elaborately rationalize why we were going to do black instead of white, pink instead of blue, or whatever decision we had to make, just became really wearying. And now sometimes I just say, well, we're going to try it this way. And the reason we're going to try it this way is that you two are at loggerheads and somebody needs to make a decision. And I think people take great comfort in the idea that I'm making a decision just because it's my job to make the decision, not because I've got some God-given ability to see the right better than anyone else.
Build a software factory. Let's talk about that.
Well, the idea here is just that, you know, sooner or later you're going to create an enormous amount of technical debt as you build your product. I now meet lots of people who think of themselves as startup people or hackers, where they're obsessed with architecture. If it's not built in Scala, if we're not doing it this way, then you can't build the product. When in fact, if you are always about to run out of money, you just incur a massive amount of technical debt. You just lurch from one idea to the next until you get to product market fit. But sooner or later, as you get that fit, you want to invest in your software factory. You know, Bill Gates argued that Microsoft won in the 80s and 90s because it had the best software factory. It spent a third of its engineering resources on engineering itself, on making it easier for Microsoft to build software. And so I just think every company that reaches a scale point, when you have that inflection moment and you realize you've got a real product, the more resources you can invest in your platform so that it's easier for coders to check in their product, to test their product, to release their product, the better. This is our chief technology officer. And now I would just say that, you know, 20% of Redfin engineering is really focused on making it easier for other Redfin engineers to check in code. There's still a lot of resources in the cloud, but eventually you're just going to have to pay down your technical debt and make all your other engineers more productive. It's the best investment you can possibly make.
Okay.
You know, Jeff Bezos is sort of famous for talking about this. I met him once, and you know, I just told him that sometimes I felt that consistency was the hobgoblin of small minds. You're going to feel this pressure as the CEO to be oracular, to be right all the time. And someone will say, well, wait a minute, 3 months ago you were against this, why are you for it now? And you shouldn't let that person trap you in a mistake. You should be explicit about, I've actually changed my mind. And sometimes you don't even need new data. You don't need some new phenomena outside of you. You can just say, I finally got a good night's sleep and I realized that this was a mistake. And the more you can own that mistake, the more you can liberate everybody else on your team. So almost all of these early slides are really about the fact that you're going to be groping around in the darkness. And you want to make it okay to make mistakes so that other people can do that too. I think it'll release a lot of stress in the organization. So I just say, oops, I screwed up. And then other people will too. Yeah, this is a little bit more personal, but it's along the same theme. This is my wife, and that's our son. He's going to his first day of kindergarten, and he looks as worried as he is. But, you know, my own challenge as an entrepreneur is, you know, I go up and down. I get really blue about the product. There was a while where I just didn't think we were going to make it, and I felt like I wasn't getting any better, that I'd come home at night, I'd put the kids to bed, I would lie face down on the bed as soon as they were asleep and just say, I'm so tired of myself. The things that I'm working on never get any better. And I just feel like I'm such an asshole at work. And then my wife would say, well, do you think you're going to be better 10 years from now? And I say, honestly, I really don't think I am. And she would say, well, what were you like 10 years ago? Were you worse back then? And that I was very eager to agree with. I was a total asshole back then. And so she said, you've somehow gotten better over the next 10 years, over the last 10 years, but you think that process has now stopped. And I guess there's this idea that as an entrepreneur, a founder, a CEO, you want to present yourself as perfect, but if instead you can present yourself as a work in progress, it really helps. You know, the happiest people in the world are born again, not necessarily born again Christian, they could be born again Jewish or Muslim or what have you. But just this idea that I'm not invested in who I was, I'm invested in who I'm gonna be, is a good way to run yourself, and it's a good way to run a company.
Okay.
There he is, there he is. I gotta skip this one, because I already talked about it.
Money, right, we got it. Get to the good part.
This was the original investor in Redfin. His name is Paul Goodrich at Madrona. And I used to come into these board meetings and say, the engineering schedule is late, we're over budget. And just deliver an enormous amount of bad news. And he would always say, get to the good part. Is there a happy
is there any good news?
And what I found is that you can tell people anything. You can tell people that we are going to run out of money in 3 months. We're not sure which customers are going to buy our product. We haven't found a market yet. But if you end it with, but I believe we can win. This is what I think we're going to do next. That's your job, is to be an optimist. That's your job, to say, what are we going to do about this? And so part of the discipline is just whenever you're presenting, even if you're working at Google or Facebook or what have you, and you're talking about some costs, you should say, well, here's how it could benefit us. Here's what could happen that could be really good. And I think as an entrepreneur, that's even more important, that you somehow have to say, it might be a 1 in 10 shot, but this is the way I think we can thread the needle. This is how we can win. And that is the basic story that you're repeating constantly, because your employees are waking up in the morning absolutely terrified. They have this existential doubt that the company's going to fail. And even if you told them at 4 o'clock yesterday how you can win, you need to repeat that the following morning. And so I would just kind of rehearse to myself, this is the way we could win. And
right,
sometimes that gets narrower and sometimes that gets broader.
Well, there is a theory that if you look at the wall when you're driving around in the NASCAR, like,
you'll drive into the wall.
You'll drive into the wall, and like, you want to be looking at the road ahead, not the wall. Not everything can go wrong. And the list of reasons of why a company can fail is always a magnitude larger than the reasons it can succeed. So the only choice you really have, if you're going to be, you know, intellectually honest, is to say, this is the path to winning. There are a lot of paths to failure, for sure.
Yeah.
But this is the path to winning. We know this is the path. Let's try to follow that path.
Yeah, and I think there's a corollary to that. When I couldn't quite figure out how Redfin was going to win, I kept coming back to this idea that real estate's a $60 billion market, that the real estate agent is the least respected profession in America, and that there had to be a way to make it better, that it was a worthwhile problem. And so...
It isn't really the worst, the least respected?
It's 23 out of 23. The survey's from, I think, 2006. You know, firefighter was at the top because 9/11 had happened recently. Yeah. Doctors always come out near the top, but... You know, if you look at American Beauty or some other movie like that, whenever you need a shyster, usually his job or her job is real estate agent.
And I will sell this house today.
Yeah. Our goal is to restore honor to that profession and to couple it with technology. So,
Annette Bening is really good.
Yeah, that's Annette Bening. Yeah. But the premise here is just that I kept coming back to the problem is real. Like the solution may seem like a mirage, but the problem is real. And I always felt that if I failed, I'd have to watch someone else solve it later.
Let me just take a quick moment to thank Scott Ed Walker and the Walker Corporate Law Group for supporting This Week in Startups. The Walker Corporate Law Group is a boutique law firm specializing in the representation of entrepreneurs and startups. And I've personally known Scott for a long time. And a lot of my angel investments use him as their attorney and speak incredibly highly of him. The Walker Corporate Law Group encourages fixed fees, which they believe really helps startups, and I know it does because you don't get that surprise when you get your bill every month. And they believe, actually, at the Walker Corporate Law Group, that billable hours reward inefficiency. They want to get things done, and they want to get it done quickly and efficiently for you, keep those billable hours actually reasonable so that you can grow your startup and put the capital where it belongs in the product. All of their lawyers have decades of experience. There's no junior associates getting on-the-job training, and they provide tons of services, including M&A, licensing agreements, terms of services, and privacy policies. If you want to talk to the founder himself, Scott Ed Walker, you can call him directly at 415-979-9998. That's 415-979-9998, 979-9998, or you can email him directly, Scott at Walker Corporate Law. Scott at Walker Corporate Law, and you just put in the subject line, Jason sent me. And you can visit walkercorporatelaw.com, and you can follow Scott at Scott Ed Walker on the Twitter. Thanks, Scott, for supporting independent media like This Week in Startups.
When did it tip over where you thought, okay, this is going to work? When did that, like, oh, it's working?
It happened so gradually, there was never a moment. You know, there's this movie, Die Hard. I know I'm dating myself.
Yeah,
but they're drilling through seven walls to get into a safe.
Yeah.
And the last one is this electromagnetic shield. And they have to rely on the FBI to cut the power to the whole block.
Yeah.
And then they're dancing with money flying around everywhere. And I always thought that we'd break the seventh seal at Plumtree, at Redfin, that we'd have a singular moment where we suddenly realized we were going to win and we would literally be throwing cash. And... that is not how it happens. I think at Facebook it might have happened that way. There are a few special companies.
It happens in the movies that way. In fairness, two Death Stars went out that way.
That's true. But mostly...
Obi-Wan, right?
Yeah.
And then the Ewoks. They both... they turned down the shields.
Yeah, and that was software. What I was going to say is that usually if you find a good problem and you work hard at it and you know how to write software, you're going to make money. There is a worldwide shortage of software. There are so many problems in this universe, and most people aren't willing to work hard at it for a long time. You have to be willing to work hard at it in a way that almost no one else could. Lots of other people have tried this, and most just gave up before they were about to figure it out. And I just decided I was going to be more dogged than other people, and I think the rest of Redfin felt the same way. So, long story short, I think there's never this magic moment. I just think you keep at it.
This chart is hate mail, incoming hate mail.
I don't know what
percentage
it is.
Of emails
actually,
coming in.
If you really want to know, that's the percentage of revenue dedicated to headquarters expense. It shows increasing leverage at Redfin. But I really was just looking for a chart that looked bad. But it's actually
good. But it's good. So this means the overhead of the company is a lower portion of the company's expense.
True enough.
Got it.
But it could have been. So this is actually Austin Ligon's sort of an interesting side note. He was the founder and CEO of CarMax. He's on our board. He spoke at the Democratic National Convention 4 years ago. And just a million people came out and hated on him via Twitter and other means. If you speak for a Republican or a Democrat, there is a world that will make you miserable. So I just thought I'd mention that because of the election. But Austin basically participated in a board meeting where I said that when we save people money, we actually save people over $100 million a year that we don't have to. Our research shows that they would still give our agents a try even if we didn't save them money, and that the only reason we do is out of principle, that part of the reason we got into this was to make real estate more efficient, to give the consumer better value. And I felt honor-bound to relay this data to our board. I assumed that the board would try to insist that we stop giving away so much money. And I concluded the presentation by just saying the only conclusion a rational person would come to would be to stop doing this. And the room was completely silent, and then this guy said, can you name a great brand that was built by someone entirely rational? If you want people to have an emotional connection to what you're doing, you need to have an emotional connection to what you're doing. And the hardest thing in the world is to know all the numbers, to know what the rational thing to do is, and then to disregard it. Because most of us manage by the numbers. We do the thing that is 1% optimization, incrementally better. But occasionally, I think you have to say, this is why I'm here. And I think people will respond to this over time in a different way for the same emotional reasons that I have. And I was glad to have someone on the board. Usually it's an operator who understands the emotional reasons that you're there, that the employees are there, that the customers are working with you.
I have to say, the check back is, like, for me, the difference between Redfin being on the NPS score, like an 8 yeah. and a 10, which is the huge moment of truth is when you cross from 8 to 9.
I should have brought you to the board meeting.
You would really say, like, how lucky you referred a friend. You're like, yeah, this is, these, they're better. For sure it's an 8. But then when you're like, it's so much better because they're on your side, and the person's like, oh, wow, that sounds really good. They don't get paid, like, based on commission. They get paid based on this, and they don't have to, like, worry about their paycheck every month, and... Oh, you get to rate them? Oh, good, their bonus is based on the rating? And they're like, yeah. And get this, it's better and you get back 10K or 20K.
Yeah.
Like that piece becomes like this, it's a slam dunk.
Yeah.
Okay.
This was a saying that we told a lot of investors. So real estate's a cyclical business. It goes up and down, and the valuations of companies in real estate go up and down as a result. And so investors would ask what we would do if there was another real estate downfall. And I always quoted them, this character, Bane in The Dark Knight Rises, says he was born in the dark. And the reason I say that is that there are going to be people who jump on the bandwagon who want to be associated with you because you're successful, but there was this doughty band of warriors who stuck together through the great real estate recession and built Redfin. And those are the people I feel the most loyal to. And you want to have some sense that through the ups and downs, we're just tougher than everybody else. If your company identity is based on your commercial success, the first setback that you have will throw everyone into a tailspin. If instead, at the very best moments, you tell people there will be dark days too, and we have to remember the source of our strength, our moral compass, our rudder, our keel, is what we're really trying to do. And you create this idea that we're just badasses, that we're tougher, that we're ninjas, we're rabid squirrels, whatever your phrase is. You want people to take pride in being really cheap and really tough and really hard. Because
gritty.
Once you go soft, yeah. Yeah, it's what you want your six-year-old to be, right?
Gritty, yeah.
Yeah. And so
kids are soft.
So I don't know if Bane is the best role model for your six-year-old daughter, Jason.
I'd say that's pretty good for me. I'll take that.
Yeah. Give her a little doll. Same thing. Let's keep moving. There's more to go.
Angry pandas?
Those are rabid squirrels.
Yep.
So that does say. So let me just tell you one last little story about Redfin. I left San Francisco. I started Plumtree here with a couple of friends, and then I left because I had an older brother who couldn't stop drinking, and it was crazy. We took him to the hospital every week. I went to the hospital so often that when I was driving him to the ER, I would argue with his wife about which one we should go to because the one that was further away had better food. And I really noticed
it's
how...
dark.
Yeah, that is dark.
It's dark. It's Bane. That's Bane level.
These doctors worked really hard on him, and I felt like I'd only been working for the money in the first 10 years of my life, and I decided that I was going to become a doctor. And then at the last moment, even though I was married to a doctor, I just felt like I couldn't do it, that I really wanted to do Redfin, that it was creative and fun and exciting. And the deal I made with my wife from Kerry Park, where this photo was taken, is that it would be a good thing, not just a money-making thing. And at the time, I thought that Redfin was definitely going to be a money-making thing, and then we stepped in it, and we had lots of problems. And I felt so ashamed that I'd started a company that had been successful and now I was going to be associated with a failure. And she said, but even if it isn't commercially successful, aren't you proud that you tried to do something good? Isn't it supposed to be about something good? And just having someone on my side who was reminding me that either way, it was a good thing, was the reason I was able to keep doing that thing. And somehow you have to have a narrative where you would do this, whether it worked or not. And if you're not that invested in the idea, you shouldn't do it, because you'll find you're doing it longer than, I didn't think I was gonna be at Redfin. I'm now 10 years into Redfin. It's been the best 10 years of my life. And it's been worth it. I'm working on something that is worthy of my life's work. And so you have to figure out why your thing is a good thing and not just a money-making thing, and then convey that to everybody else. And then, like I said, when the shiitake hits the fan, you're still going to be okay. You know, this is sort of the talk that I've given in other places about taking the red pill. The reason Redfin failed at first was because we were trying to automate the whole thing. Literally, there were people who were trying to get into houses, trying to write offers, where they had questions and they would call the office and I would just pick up the phone and put it down because I didn't know how to answer the questions. And mostly I just thought we just need to write more and more software. And eventually we just decided we need to hire real estate agents. And it was a weird thing. I used to come back to San Francisco. I was up in Seattle. It was raining all the time. I was in a seasonal business. The winters were tough. And my friends would say, oh, look, it's Glenn. He's not in software anymore. He's a real estate agent. And I would be like, come on, guys, don't say that. And now I've really embraced that. I want to make a difference in the real world. And I think to do that, sometimes you have to have a real world operation. It was so hard to get people to fund that we used to have to start every presentation by saying, look, there's something really weird about Redfin. Like, we've got a website and all that stuff you like, but we have this other weird thing. We have our own employee real estate agents, lots of them. And like we like 100 VCs passed on us before one took the bait. This is a picture of people climbing Mount Rainier. I don't know why I included this. I climbed Mount Rainier. I was excited.
That's a good reason to include it.
Yeah, I want everyone to know I climbed that mountain. I'm not a mountain climber. And I got up to the top of it, and I'm very melodramatic. I had a slight headache, but I thought I was going to die. And all I could think was that I should have been nicer to people. I thought, like, if you're an entrepreneur, you are an extremely driven person. If there was someone who was more ambitious for Redfin than I am, that person should have my job. She really should. And sometimes, you know, you forget the profit and the loss, and you just think about all the people you fired, all the people you've pushed really hard, and I would just remember to be nice to people, too.
It's interesting. I haven't had that thought yet. Maybe
I tried to go through this quickly, Jason.
Bryce, haven't had that thought yet, right? Bryce, like, no comment. He left 3 months ago. Listen, Glenn, this has been amazing. Let's take one question. One question. Who's got an amazing, tight, succinct question? This has been a great talk, by
just
the way.
A short question. Only, yeah.
Yeah. A good, solid question. Come on now. I didn't give you guys enough time. I heard a rumor you guys are going public next year.
If we were really going public, we would not be able to talk about going public.
That's true. But we Snap filed today. I'll ask it another way. Snap filed today.
Yep.
What do you think about Snap and then eventually Airbnb or Uber filing in the next year? Does that set a certain stage for startups in your zone?
I feel kind of crabby about that question, actually. I think if you're going public because there's going to be a Snapchat pop, you shouldn't be going public, because when that pop goes away, you're still going to be public.
Good reason.
There's a 12-year backlog in IPOs. The banks are working night and day, lining up the deals. I am more worried about that than anything else. I mean, like, not than anything else in the world. There's a lot to worry about now. But as far as the IPO market's concerned, what I'm worried about is not that it won't be open, but that it will be jammed, packed.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This 12-year backup is just crazy. And you know what the irony of all this is? Somebody was telling me, like, why are you upset about Trump, you know, getting elected? And I said, well, you know, there's a lot of reasons, you know, I sort of started thinking about it. And I said, yeah, but you're so stupid. Like, it's going to be great for your portfolio, lower taxes, you're going to be able to sell shares in companies at lower tax base, whatever. And I said, wow, that's really not why I'm in it for it exactly. Not really what I'm thinking. But it is some weird silver lining to all this that $1 trillion in infrastructure, the market's going to go crazy. The market seems to be rewarding the lower tax basis that and the repatriation of taxes that Trump's going to do. It's going to be good for business, at least in this next 4 years, is what most people believe.
This is a difficult subject for me. I canvassed for another candidate, not for Trump. But
shocked. Glenn, shocked.
But no, half of America voted for him.
Yeah.
And one quarter. Something like half of America voted for him.
Half of the voting population voted.
I actually
voted.
Want to half be heard on voted, this point. Voted. Half of America voted for him. I really resented it when Republicans pronounced Obama dead on arrival and were opposed to him, not because of his policies, but because of who he was. And I have always promised every Tuesday night that there's an election that if my person doesn't win, I'm going to support the other person. There is plenty of evidence to suggest that I will not like some of the policies of the person who has been elected. But I am an American. I am a patriot. I want him to do well. We should all want him to do well.
There's no better place to stop. And we tried to keep the political discussions to a limit, but I think it is important to talk about it in the business context.
Yeah.
All right, Glenn, this has been amazing.
Thank you, Jason.
Thank you for the service. It's such a great product. If you haven't used it, please use Redfin. It's amazing. So I'm really excited to have my next guest here. Angel investors have a very special place in the ecosystem because they take a lot of the risk. They get in there earlier and earlier. VCs are moving the goalposts further and further. They expect more and more performance in order to get that Series A. And even the people doing Series A in a lot of cases look a lot like Series B. These to me, historically, where they just want a sure bet. But angels, it's a little bit different, right? They're willing to write that early check and take the risk. And Pejman Nozad is going to talk to us about going from the addict above the yogurt shop to being one of the great angel investors of recent history. Please welcome Pejman.
Thank you.
Thanks so much, Jason, for coming.
I appreciate it inviting
you. Do you have a deck?
No, I think we have some slides we can talk later on.
Oh, okay, good. Here, pass me that. Let me pass me that thing here. We'll look through some slides.
I think it's for
now. You're an angel investor, or you started as an angel investor.
Sure.
But tell everybody how you got started.
Sure. First of all, thank you so much. It's such an honor to be here, and thank you, everyone. You know, I came here in 1992 by accident. I didn't plan to come to the U.S. I came here. I didn't speak a word English, and I had only $700 in my pocket, and I was in love with the girl in Iran, and I thought I'm going to lose her. So in 92, payphone was so expensive, so I started to call her every day and ran out of money the first 2 weeks. So not knowing the language and didn't have money, my first job was working in a car wash. And you know, fast forward, my English improved, and I got a job at a yogurt shop in Redwood City, and I wanted to go get married the girl I love, but I didn't want to ask my father to pay for it. And I thought the best way is just going homeless. You're just not having a home, don't pay for anything. And then the owner said, you can't go homeless. Why? There's an attic up there, and you want to live there. And I lived for 6 months above that attic.
Yogurt shop.
Yes, it was literally an attic. It was no room, no air. No window. It was just kind of the storage place, and then ceiling was so low. So I studied English over there, opened up the yogurt shop, and somehow I landed a job in rug gallery in downtown Palo Alto. And you know, the rug gallery, you go to people's home, and after 6-7 years, I figure out all of the people who are buying carpets are either venture capitalists, people like Jason, and you know, I was really amazed by.
I can't afford those rugs. These rugs go for like 50 grand, right?
Yes.
They're expensive.
It was very expensive. You know, very Persian. So I was really amazed, not by how much wealth they have, but just, you know, I felt that this is a community. I'm in center of it, and they're changing the world to be a better place, and I wanted to be one of them. So I started to educate myself how these things work, startup, venture capitalists, and so on. And I started to put a lot of networking events. And imagine in 90s, maybe a few people like Jason were doing it. It was no TechCrunch, no YCs. So I started to create a really strong deal flow. And one day I you know, went to the owner of the gallery, who was an older gentleman, and he had a lot of trust in me. I said, we can sell carpets forever, but I think we should invest in early stage startups. So that's how we started. You know, we started to make horrible, I think we have the worst record in history first 9 months. But I got very lucky to meet Andy Rubin very early on, and that changed really my perspective of
the founder of Android.
Yes, and he started at that time. He started Danger, yeah. And then Android.
Danger was a beeper.
No, it was actually perhaps the most sophisticated smartphone at that time, but it was just so ahead of their time. I don't know if you remember hip hop. I mean, it was
flipped.
Yes, exactly. T-Mobile said. So anyway, just Andy gave me a really good perspective of a world-class founder, and then after that, I started to create.
Did you invest in Andy?
Yeah, I was the first check in Andy.
Wow. So, just so for people who are, the story is going very fast right now. You don't speak English.
Yes.
You love a girl. You're out of money because the phone bills are ridiculous at that time. There's no voice over IP. You come to Silicon Valley somehow. Now, were you chasing the girl here? Is that the idea? She lived here?
Say it again.
Was the girl living here?
No, it wasn't. She was in Iran. That's why I lost the whole money, because like $5 per minute at that time,
so
I had a bag of quarters going to pay phones.
So you decided to come here for some reason. What was the reason you decided to come to America?
You know, I actually went to Germany. I actually studied in Iran, German. I played professional soccer. My parents were in Germany. I went over there. They offered me to play for a professional club and pay for my university. My brother somehow left Iran early and had this American dream. He pushed me one day to go to US embassy. And you know, history, I was a reporter in Iran, sports reporter, and they gave me a visa to come. I don't know why I came, to be honest with you, but I think this is the point I want to raise here before we get to the rest of it. You know, I came in 1992 as an Iranian Muslim, and for a few months I was illegal, but America opened its arm to me. I think I never felt that I'm foreigner. I never felt that I'm an outsider. America gave me the opportunity to really grow, to create a family and build my life here. And somehow in a magical way, it gave me the opportunity to help entrepreneurs. I'm forever grateful. And whatever I do, it feels so small compared to what America gave me. My worry is the next Pejman might not have a place in today's America.
Oh, no, definitely not. We're shutting all that down.
Yeah.
And in fact, you know, we might want to send you back now.
Sure.
Congratulations on creating many jobs, being highly successful.
I'm a U.S. citizen, by the way.
And paying tons of taxes. But you know what? That citizenship, we could just do an executive order and change it. I mean, I'm being farcical here, but you cannot feel not concerned as an immigrant.
For sure.
Is it scary in a way what's happened?
You know, I didn't know how to explain to my daughter. She's 16 years old. Both of our kids were born here. And especially if you have a girl at home, they're very sensitive. I really couldn't explain it. So, and I think worry. I mean, most of our founders are immigrants, so they're worried. Some of them, they're on.
Your daughter's got two things to worry about. One, you're an immigrant family. Two, she's a woman. And the person who was elected joked about assaulting women.
Yes.
And 12 women came forward who had been assaulted. I mean, they're all liars. And none of them are telling the truth. They're all risking their entire lives to come forward and say that, obviously.
There's no
truth to it.
I think it's very unfortunate to be even having this discussion here in the middle of, I mean, beginning of 21st.
But it is crazy that we're having this discussion, and who knows where it's going to go. But you decide, hey, I got the job as working in a car wash, which just man to man, like coming from being a journalist in another country,
it was very hard.
It's humbling, is it not?
It was humbling, but I tell you two things. It was very hard, but I was the best car washer the world has ever seen.
So
I'm telling you.
You put your all into it.
Because I knew, exactly, and that's what I want to see in founders, because I knew this is not going to stay. Actually, I bought a car for $750 payment, for five payments for $150, but I didn't have money.
What kind of car was it?
It was a Chevy 1972 hatchback.
It was a Chevy piece of shit. I know. Yeah. It's a great car.
And the car broke, and I never paid the last payment. I'm still regretting it so much. I couldn't find the owner to pay.
Got it. So. Oh, but he put you on an installment plan.
Yeah.
Which speaks to, like, kind of the great thing about it. Then you get the job. You get a big, big bump in salary, I'm assuming. What did they pay you at the car wash?
Oh, I don't remember. Just for food.
Yeah. then you get the job at the minimum wage job, probably.
Yeah, sure. Always was just minimum wage until I went to the rug gallery. I became a really good salesman. One year, I sold $8 million worth of carpets. That's a lot of carpets.
That's a lot of carpets.
A lot of your friends paid for them.
Yeah. And some of them were famous venture capitalists from Sequoia.
Correct.
I can tell the story because they told it. But I think it was Doug Leone or somebody from the group. You had come to put the carpet in their house.
Yeah, I think, and I invited him to our office, and I said, I can put you in front of the best founders, especially Iranian at Stanford, and he said, show me. So 2 weeks after, I brought like 100 Iranian founders from Stanford or all over. He really liked it. So my deal flow started to really kick in, and actually, Andy Rubin was a little bit tipping point, but I became very lucky to meet Dropbox founder very early, Lending Club founders, and you know the story after.
Yeah. Well, no, I don't think they know the story. So let's not fast forward too quickly here.
Sure.
You are working at the rug store. You start selling rugs to people who work at Sequoia or other venture firms. You convince the person who owns the rug store, hey, you happen to be on University Avenue in Palo Alto. We're in the middle of this. Let's try to do some angel investing. You make some terrible bets, and then you strike gold with Danger and Andy Rubin. You make some money there, I guess.
Yes. I mean, it was just long. They raised so much money. I learned it the hard way. So we got diluted as an angel investor. But they sold the company for $500 million.
So you make a little bit of money.
Sure.
Now, what's going through your mind when you look back on your life, just at that point in time, if you remember, when you start bringing founders to Sequoia or other places, do you feel like a bit of a fraud? Like, maybe I don't belong here? Or do you just say, like, this is what America is. This is what it's about.
There was no
I belong
doubt.
Here.
Yeah, I no doubt that I want to be part of it. And I knew if I worked really hard, I help other people, something great will happen. I didn't have a 10-year plan. You know, I raised fund now.
Why did you believe that, though? Why did you believe that if you worked hard and you made these bets and you were a good member of the community, what made you believe? Because in Iran, that would not have resulted in this kind of success, I don't believe.
Yeah,
what made you believe that would work?
I think the experience just starting from car wash, coming to yogurt shop and then selling carpets and then meeting venture capitalists, it was just, I was looking around and it's happening here, it's just all about me. If I cannot execute it, it's not the community, it's just me, I cannot do it.
So was that easy? How long did that take? 10 years? That time from when you start washing cars?
Yeah, 92, I got the carpet job. At 94, we started to angel investing late 99, early 2000, which you know, angel investing wasn't really fashionable. You still had to go to Sandhill Road or go to people's home in Athens and get a check. It wasn't like this.
Yeah.
It was nothing like this that you create so many amazing people come here. So I had to put a lot of events, do a lot of networking events, get to know, because I don't come from technical background, but I built a great team around me. These are all my customers in carpet, whatever, like VP of engineering of Cisco, and I was going to them and they really loved what I was doing it. So
it's like, amazing.
Yeah, unbelievable. I think, you know, one of my closest friend is Lou Mantulli. He was the founding engineer of Netscape and he's the guy who invented cookies. He always was coming to my, you know, meetings and providing feedback, and founders really loved that I brought somebody his caliber to rug shop. I mean, it's just like movie, but it was reality.
It is like a movie. Then you wind up investing in Dropbox. Tell us, how did you meet Drew, and how did you wind up getting involved in Dropbox?
I don't know if you remember, and I know you remember, YC was around 8 to 12 teams.
Yeah.
It was in small place, like 50 people, 100 people. So I was going to the YC events. This is fast forward, so 2000, I think 6 or 7. So like 6, 7 years after, I got a good sense of what's going on in the Valley, created a kind of a taste of what kind of founders I want to work with. And I met Drew and Arash, and they get like this 2 minutes pitch over there. And I thought it just really resonated what they have been building over there. And I reached out to Drew and Arash, and being Iranian, you know, I invite both of them for Persian tea to the gallery. And I don't know, you know, when Drew came to the gallery, he thought he's in the wrong address, because, well, this is a carpet guy, it's not a VC firm.
Right.
And then they figure out, they brought him back. We had a beautiful boardroom in the back with carpets around, so very intimidating.
Right.
So, and they said, we have an offer for $250,000, but if you have a, like, amazing VCs, we'll consider it. So I called Doug Leone. I had a good relationship with him, Sequoia. And I said, Doug, I met this pretty amazing guys. I think you should meet them. So this was Thursday. Friday morning, we went there. It was Samir Gandhi. Samir was at that time still partner at Sequoia, and Doug. And they came out and said, we really like these guys. They should come and give a presentation to partner meetings on Monday. But Mike Moritz is not there. And I knew when Mike is not there, they don't make a decision. And I said, if you guys don't make a decision by Monday, they take this $250,000. They called me back Friday night. I said, Pejman, can you come to their apartment with Mike Moritz Saturday morning? So it was me, Mike Moritz, Samir Gandhi, and Duran Arash is an apartment maybe twice. I mean, at this size, maybe. So it took around an hour and a half, and Mike Moritz said, I really like this guy. So they went back Monday to give a presentation, and then Samir called me and said, let's go to dinner. We went to this cafe in San Francisco. It took 4 hours. These guys want to raise $250,000. Obviously, Sequoia want to invest more, and I want to make sure the deal doesn't break.
Right.
So, and with a piece of napkin, we figured out what to do, and then Thursday, the deal was done.
Wow. But if you don't get Michael Moritz, who at the time is the most famous venture capitalist in the world, you call him and say...
I didn't. I actually told Doug that...
And Doug said he'll come on Saturday.
Yes.
So the most powerful VC in the world at the time, and considered one of the top three of all time, decides on a Saturday he'll go to these kids' apartment when they're a two-person company. What does that say about them as a firm?
I think they're exceptional. I think they pull these things around. People think it takes forever, but once it is the opportunity, I think that meeting we had Friday morning, they really figure out these two kids are really special. And they trusted me when I said there's $250,000 on the table.
Right.
That you should move
quickly.
Consider. Yeah.
So now you've learned some things about startups over this 20-year journey. Maybe we'll go through some of them here.
I think I look for people like myself in startups, people who are not afraid to take big risks. I think I like founders who are very confident when they're going, but at the same time, they are kind of paranoid in a healthy way. It means like they question themselves every day. So as you're a captain of the ship, you know where you're going, but you can turn around. So I really look for those founders who are taking risk on behalf of their ideas. Normally, if you have an entrepreneurship bug in yourself and you want to start something, but at the same time you have scheduled a job interview at Google, you're not ready to do it. So I think, as you mentioned, you have to give all in order to see what's going on. I think this is perhaps the most important thing I learned. I learned a lot of people can build product, only a few can build companies, and I believe the entire ecosystem in tech is built on top of solving real problem, not chasing big ideas. I think when entrepreneurs taking too big of a task early on, they're burned out. But if you are just focusing on small tasks like connecting taxi drivers to passengers, storing files on the cloud, or creating a chat room for your employees, these are the companies become Uber and Dropbox and Slack of the world.
Yeah.
This is actually a great story. Actually, I was, it's a kind of a roller coaster emotionally. You wake up in the morning, this best thing you're doing in the world. By noon, you say, well, this is the worst thing I'm doing in the world because it's just so hard. I mean, just building companies is not easy.
Right. But
I think you have to have the stamina. It's just not getting rattled here easily. I remember I had a discussion with the founder who said, wow, Pejman, he had a hard time raising money. He said, this is like war zone. And, I grew up in war. I was a kid when Iran-Iraq war happened. And I explained to him, he said, in Iran, they were bombing us every night. Almost every single night, Iraqi jets were coming over Tehran. And, what it happens, because of Iran's anti-aircraft, these jets couldn't come low. And instead of dropping the bomb, what they were doing was just breaking the sound barrier and to shatter the windows. And, I was a young kid, and I had this idea, maybe I should go and sell duct tapes to all the stores.
Yeah.
It's a good idea.
Growth business.
Yeah, and I went over there, and I bought wholesale this duct tape. I went from morning all the way till night, a street as long as El Camino Real, to tell the store owners, this Iraqi jet's coming tonight, this window will shatter to you, and these tapes help you. You know how many tapes I sold? Zero.
They didn't believe you?
Nobody.
No product market fit?
No, I think this is what happens. I think a good founder would have not give up. I gave up the first day.
Ah.
I think the good founder would have maybe picked different street, maybe a different pitch,
yeah.
Maybe a different color of the duct tape. So that's why I'm not an entrepreneur, I'm an investor. So
it's it must be really special to have you as an investor, because whenever you complain as a founder, you get to hear about real hardship.
Sure.
Like they actually get to understand exactly how privileged they are.
I think this is something I just brought it up. I think the founders are obsessively focused and persistent. I gave up on the first day, but I didn't try anything else. And you know, I had the privilege and honor to work with people like Andy Rubin, seeing people like Drew. These guys are insanely focused on what they do. I think it's just pretty incredible. You almost don't see them because they're almost focused on building something really great. And I look for this, and I think it's very easy to find these traits among the founders. I just met a founder from Harvard Business School. He had a scholarship, had this idea to start a company, and he used his scholarship to pay for it. Then he didn't have a place to sleep. So he lived in the Harvard Law School library illegally for 3 months.
That works. You guys must have gotten along great.
Yes. Vision, I think this is where it becomes really confusing. I think most of people, they can't distinguish between vision and the goal. And I think it's really, really important. I think the founders are building this category-defining companies that have a vision, they stick to it. And you need to have that in order to be a large company, rather than a goal of raising a Series A. I think you need to think beyond that, and this is something I really look into when I have conversation with founders.
And by the way, back to the vision part, how do you know people have both the big vision, but you said earlier they're solving a real problem? How do you guide founders to balance that, right? Because if you get too caught up in the vision and you have some grand vision and you're not tactical enough, and you know, we've seen this many times, they think they're going to change the world, but they can't even get the first product out the door. Sure. Or they can't get a good NPS score, net promoter score. They can't get good reviews for their product. How do you mentor founders to think about that?
I think it's intellectual honesty. I think you have to be honest with you that what you're capable to build now versus what this company will look like in 10 years, and take really baby step while you have this vision. I think people put so much pressure on themselves, what should happen in the next 5 to 10 years, versus you have to really build something really great. And I love the founders who are really focusing on building one thing really great and to become the best out of it.
We're gonna take some questions from the audience. I'm sure you have some questions, and so you can line up here and we'll take them. What's a company that pitched you at the rug store?
Yes.
And you said, I don't get it, and you missed, and you regret it.
Facebook. I tell you the story. Actually, Facebook, I mean, Wall Street wrote an article on me the day of IPO, and this is the story. So my partners who own the Rug Gallery, they own a lot of real estate businesses, and one of them is 165 University Avenue, which is a very famous, lucky building. Google started there, Logitech started there, and PayPal started there. So I got this call one day, and the guy said, I'm Sean Parker. Peter Thiel asked me to call you because you guys have an real estate here and has a lot of car money. We have this little company called Leave Facebook, and Peter really wanted us to start there. I met Sean, I brought him for tea, and I was just really amazed.
What's in the tea, by the way?
Yeah, I can't tell you. I have to kill you if I tell you.
Is this the opium tea? Yeah. I've heard about this tea.
That's the one.
I think I had it at Burning Man. It's pretty good. Yeah. Keep going.
So basically, I really was mesmerized by how Sean is seeing the future. It was just amazing salesperson. Yeah. And I said, we want your real estate. I said, we can give it to you, but we have to invest. And he said, we can't because we just signed a deal with Accel. They're wiring $10 million or $15 million. I remember it was at $85 million valuation. And I said, okay, we can't do it. He went back, and after 3 days, he called. He said, well, I figured out that you can invest $50,000 in the result. It was $49,998.13. Down to the wire, and an email came in with like huge, just to the wire, just, and then it was an attachment to it for a lease agreement, and our real estate office didn't agree to the lease agreement.
That fifth.
So that's $100 million valuation to like $350 billion.
Hold on a second.
That's 100. That's 3,005x.
3,500.
Yeah, x to today. Well, I think it was my mistake,
and
I tell you what was my mistake. I think my mistake was I didn't take Sean to meet my partners who run the real estate. I was just explaining what Facebook is, and I think had them seen Sean, they would have changed their mind and given that space for free.
Right. So it's the hustle. Back to the hustle. Hey, by the way, what? How do you work with startups today? Because
so I in 2013
they still do the tea or no?
No, I gave it tea. So in 2013 I started this fund Pear with my partner who gave it. I think is amazing talk, Mara Hutchinson.
Oh,
she was
great.
A founder, CEO of one of our portfolio companies.
She also did speed dating. She's very diligent.
Yes. She came from Barcelona, got her PhD. Amazing woman, MIT Lifetime Achievement Award, and she never invested in any company. I never started a company. It was a great match. I was investor in her company in 2003. So we raised two funds. Our first fund is $50 million, and the second fund is $75 million. And we invest, same thing, ground zero work, but have more capital, more people.
Got it. Okay, so now it's time for a question. No need for your name or company, unlike Yossi Vardy. We just want you to ask a concise question. Go.
What's your biggest personal challenge in life these days, and how do you try to tackle it?
Good question.
I think it's being a good father, being a good husband. I think it's the first thing. I always wake up in the morning, just being a good friend to people who help me. I think it's always time when you have so many companies to work around the time. In work, I just don't want to get comfortable with what I've done last 20 years. I think it's very easy that I tell myself I know what's going on. And I think I just want to make sure that I can go out of business every day.
Mm. You try to stay humble, huh?
Yeah. That's the right word. Thank you.
Yeah. I think we're all trying. Some of us succeed, some of us don't.
Hi. Someone from a very persistent country, South Africa, where Elon Musk is from. And
sure. I like your soccer
never
team.
Never gives up.
You like the soccer team?
Bofana.
Okay.
So a quick question. If I had to look at what got you into things and taking a giant step in the beginning of venture capital, it was being a Trojan horse in amongst all of Silicon Valley and letting you pass through and meet a whole bunch of people that you wouldn't naturally do and get some insight. To me, I think a lot of the success of the bigger guys these days is that they are Trojan horses. They're putting out products that are Trojan horses, Google, Facebook, etc.
And the question?
Would you say that both as yourself, would you say that Trojan horse factor played a role in getting you going in the venture
capital? Okay, we got to a question, so do you understand it?
Somehow. I think
it's referring to the rug business, like, do you think that was a key piece?
I was somehow on the most important street in the most important time in technology era, and that's University Avenue.
Yeah.
Everything was happening there.
So the time and the place were important.
Correct, but I think somehow I recognized it. You could have passed by, there were so many, I mean, it's like, this gallery is like 40 years, maybe they have like 200 salespeople came and go.
Yeah.
I just realized there's an opportunity, I was curious to learn, I never thought about being wealthy part of it. I just thought this is an amazing community, I want to be part of it.
Being in the game is important, right? Like just getting yourself into the game. We had on the stage earlier somebody who's in, was it Mumbai? No, he's in Bangalore. And he won the IBM competition, and I begged him, such a good company to come to America and to move to Palo Alto, to move to San Francisco. It really does make a difference.
Sure.
It's just so much easier when you're here. You're part of it.
But you're here, but you're kind. You help others. Yeah. I think that's the key part of it. And people recognize it.
If you're of service, if you help people, it goes a long way in this community.
Very much so.
We'll take a final question.
I think you were next.
Did you marry the girl?
Yes, we just celebrated our 23rd anniversary.
23rd anniversary. Okay, sure. We'll take the final question. Go ahead.
Okay. So I bet there are a lot of founders out here whom you have not invested in who would love for you to mentor them or coach them. What does it take for somebody to be able to have some of your time? Like, what do you look for?
It's Pejman at Pear.vc.
Yeah. What's the, when you, at this point in your career, what draws you to actually take a meeting? So like on a tactical basis, if there's something that comes in an email that you just say, gosh, you know, this reason, I could put my finger on it, that's the reason I need to take that meeting.
I pay a lot of attention to my immediate network. So if it comes from you, it's go top of the list because I know it passes your filter.
Right.
And I have some amazing friends around me.
Yeah, likewise, right?
Yeah, so I think you just, we take it, all of us making very serious because we know it passes. You know me, you know what kind of founders I want to work with. But I think it's just more thoughtful messages. They got to know me a little bit. So I think
they know who they're emailing.
Yes, and what they're asking. Some people say, "Oh, Pejman, we're raising $10 million." You know, they haven't done their homework. I don't write a $10 million check.
No.
So I know this. You eliminate, but the people who really get to know me, they can craft an email that get my attention. I don't know what is the formula, but there's a way to do it.
Hey, not to dwell on it, but you are the epitome of the American dream.
Thank you. It's a
privilege to have you here. And just on behalf of the audience,
I feel so humble and honored.
Yeah, well, America's humbled to have people come to the country and build value like this. I wonder, how did you feel on Wednesday morning when you saw the results? As somebody who's, you know, benefited so much from the American dream.
You know, I was really surprised to see that half of America is so angry.
Yeah.
People who I thought I don't know them.
Right.
I thought maybe we live in the bubble here, we don't understand what's going on. As I mentioned, it was just very hard as an immigrant to see the wars going on around and, you know, having a daughter. It was just very difficult to take it. But I always have hope for the future. So that's why we live here.
Yeah, it's a great country, and you're a great American.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Jason. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Pejman, what a story, huh?
Our iTunes review of the week is from Zilling Gong. Jason's experience as an entrepreneur and successful angel investor adds to the extraordinary guests in the trenches, toiling to make humanity better via startups.